So the next session will be the Fireside Chat with Steve Chen. So as many of you all know that Steve is the co-founder, he was the co-founder and the CTO of YouTube. And within a year, he led YouTube through the Google acquisitions for $1.65 million. And our moderator is Frank. He's the co-founder and the partner of SparkLabs Global Group. So without further introduction, let's welcome Steve Chen and Frank.
Hello. G'day, Steve. How are you? Okay, so, well, with no, probably no introduction to you all, but Steve Chen, so co-founder and CTO at YouTube, which I think probably most of you know. So what we're going to do, we're going to have a little chat, and we're going to have a chat about a pretty wide-ranging number of topics. And we're going to try and address some of the things that are obviously happening today, and but also some of the challenges and opportunities for the Taiwan ecosystem, which is what we're so passionate about. So without further ado, Steve, why are you back?
I've seen a lot of people on their iPhones. Do you think anybody's using YouTube right now?
It's possibly true, yeah.
Or I recording something
very
for
true.
YouTube.
Yeah.
Well, quickly, I grew up in, I was born in Taiwan. I moved over to the U.S. in Chicago, where I went to elementary school, junior high, high school, college, before moving to the Bay Area in 1999. In the Chicago area, I think I had my sort of first sense into technology. This was still back in the sort of the early 90s, just about the time when the internet was starting, Netscape, Mozilla, it was just coming out at the time. Went to the sort of math and science academy pretty early on, moving away from home at the age of 15, and then kind of sticking around and focusing on areas of science, technology, math, and frankly meeting the first two co-founders of PayPal at the age of 15. Then went to Champaign-Urbana in Illinois from 96 to 2000 to 99, and that's where I ended up meeting Max Levchin, who was part of that whole PayPal Mafia group. And it was a big decision back then as to, it was sort of the, I had about 6 weeks left before I was going to get my degree in computer science. Had an ICQ call with Max at the time to say, look, we know when first semester is going to be over, but we need you here right now, so make that decision. And like many, many decisions in the coming years after 99, that just happened to be sort of 3 days later, I'd set foot down in a San Francisco airport and walked into Palo Alto University Ave, 165 University Ave, where Google was founded, and then where PayPal was founded. And you know that going in the office on Sunday and meeting everybody from Peter Thiel, Max, and then also at the time, the first day I was in San Francisco Bay Area, I ended up meeting Chad Hurley, who would later become the co-founder of YouTube. But we'll definitely get into a little bit more in detail about what happened during that period. On the big picture side of things, this was 99 when I moved into the Bay Area, and there worked from everything from dot-com crash, PayPal, public, the acquisition of eBay, the fight against eBay, the acquisition by eBay, and then sort of starting YouTube, the kind of similar sort of competition when it was trying to get YouTube starting to get it out there, where were you going to put it on? So at the time, it was MySpace, kind of the precursor to Facebook at the time, and then ultimately sort of a very sort of dramatic acquisition, and then post-acquisition. But the big thing is, after all of this, just about 8 months ago, I'd moved with both my family and myself back to Taiwan permanently. And the this is one of the events that I was looking forward to the most, because the big thing of with all the periods that I'd been back to Taiwan was sort of scratching my head, because all the missing pieces that the Bay Area was missing, right? And so the difficulties in hiring an engineer for less than $150,000. I mean, these are straight grads with barely a, you know, still a diploma that was wet with print, and then the next day you're making $150,000. And there's, and it turns out to be mostly the interview is flipped around, where it's the candidate that's interviewing whether or not I want to work here. And it seems like that's the flip in Taiwan. The number of just the ability to be able to cohesively get a group of people to be on the same focus, same goals, that's starting to get harder and harder, because there's so much promotion of the individualist contribution in the Bay Area now that it's really difficult once you start getting beyond the founders themselves with this original idea to be able to recruit more engineers, to be able to get them to do the same thing. And so, again, that was something when meeting with the engineers and the startups here, that was something that was very different, and I thought that that would be, make it easier. And then just in general, no offense to anybody coming from the Bay Area, but Taipei is just a better place to live compared to San Francisco. So with all that said, you know, it was coming here in August of last year, and it was scratching my head as to why aren't there more successful startups, more global startups that have come out of Taipei, Taiwan. The other part of it is that there's a whole group of us in the Bay Area, and the founders of Twitch, for example, the founders of Mochi Media, founders of even Hot or Not. These are all Taiwanese Americans that were the entrepreneurs behind these companies. And furthermore, there's a disproportionate number of Taiwanese Americans that were founders and entrepreneurs in the Bay Area, much more than, you know, from Korean Americans and Singaporean Americans and Japanese Americans and even sort of Chinese Americans from China itself. People are kind of wondering, why is it that there are so many of these Taiwanese Americans that are able to successfully create these startups, yet when you kind of look at the other side of things, you fly across the Pacific and there are so many of these companies are coming out of Korea that are reaching global access, Japan, Hong Kong, Singapore, and the question is, what's the difference? What's the differentiator other than, you know, a 1,500-mile flight? You know, there has to be something more to it. So that was coming back in August of last year, trying to figure this out and getting into the later. But I think over the period of the last few months, there's just, I think, making some discoveries and understanding a little bit better now that I'm actually on the ground here and being able to see companies face to face, to be able to see what the difficulties and the differences that that sort of separate Bay Area and Taiwan.
Well, having lived in San Francisco myself, I couldn't agree more. I mean, Taipei is a brilliant place to be. And I think that's just, it's kind of like it's one of the undiscovered gems at the moment. And you know, I'm down in Singapore, you know, spending a lot of time up here. We just formed a company in climate change, which is Equilibrium, and you know, we're putting our tech team here, having looked all over why here. And now there are some great things about tech teams here and everything, but what do you think the challenges are for startups here if they want to start to really compete on the world stage? Because currently still most Taiwanese startups are kind of Taiwan, maybe Japan, maybe China, you know, still haven't had that sort of real push to try and go global. You know, what do you think is one kind of holding them back, and two, how do you compete more effectively as a Taiwanese startup?
Well, I think there are a few bullet points, but I think the umbrella over all of it is I think having a good understanding of that larger target market that you're going after, right? And so there are very innovative solutions to problems that the average Taiwanese citizen faces on a daily basis here. But to be able to mirror that, replicate that for other countries, for the US, sort of maybe in your head with reason, you believe that that's possible, but without really understanding what the sort of the daily life routines, what are the problems? What are the shortage of solutions to these problems? It's very difficult to be able to come up with a innovative startup idea to be able to fix and address a problem in which you don't really know what that solution really is. And then I was saying that it's an umbrella, but there's a lot of sort of maybe culturally, the understanding of the culture, certainly with language, certainly with, I think, when you start launching a company, you're working with, you're putting out tweets out there, you're going to dinners at night, you're meeting with other entrepreneurs on a daily basis, you're working in partnership collaborations. I mean, to be able to, when we were either trying to sell YouTube, it was over a period of 1 week, and you can meet the CEOs and the co-founders of Yahoo, and you can meet twice the co-founders of Google, all within, and you can actually go and work with the top sort of legal firms to actually make all of that happen. And they were working there on Saturdays and Sundays, all compressed into 1 week. And on Monday afternoon, you announced on the New York Stock Exchange after the closure, you have a board meeting announcement, and you say that that Google acquires YouTube. That's something that I think you just assume is possible after being in Silicon Valley for 20 years. And so I think without having been here on the ground, it wouldn't have been as clear to me that we should be, if I were in Silicon Valley still, should be treasuring this rather than taking it to be something that assumes everywhere in the world this is true.
Now, do you think, you're absolutely right, it's not about copying Silicon Valley, it's about establishing your own identity, which is very much like what Israel's done, Korea's done, Singapore has done very effectively. Here's a controversial question, but do you think Taiwanese startups and founders are ambitious enough?
I think so. I mean, I think it's a stereotype that the engineers or the entrepreneurs of Taiwan are somehow more passive and less aggressive. But I think just with all stereotypes, I think it's built on some form of validity, but at the same point, with 23 million people, a stereotype's not gonna be able to cover and describe every single person, right? And so, and when I say these Taiwanese American entrepreneurs, many of them were born and they didn't immigrate to the US until not just in elementary school, but well into sort of junior high school. And so, it was, if there's something more than just the description of their sort of day-to-day personalities. And you see that with many of the startups here. I think one of the difficulties, for example, I said I grew up in Chicago. In Chicago itself, you have Mark Andreessen, Netscape. You have even Larry Ellison, one generation before, starting Oracle, also from Chicago. Jeremy Stoppelman, Russ Simmons, the guys that started Yelp, also from Chicago. And they were wondering the same thing is, why do you guys fly to Silicon Valley before you start your companies? And I think that there's something there which is, in Chicago, it's massive. San Francisco, 7x7 square miles. In Chicago, it's difficult to be able to find, maybe you can find the co-founders of your company, but it's difficult to find the engineers that are graduating from top schools that are willing to take that risk to join a startup. There are many of them because we all grew up in Chicago, we all flew to Silicon Valley. It's hard to find though in Chicago maybe the chief financial officer that would want to leave their job that they've been at for 20 years and wanting to go join a startup in which everything is up in the air, to be able to find the head of business development, the head of customer service. It's difficult to find all of that in the Bay Area. In a way, it's a magnet. If you are willing to take the risk, then the way to prove that is to drop everything you've got, buy a one-way ticket, and land in San Francisco and hope for the best, right? And if you don't do that, and if you still stay in Chicago, if you still stay in Taiwan, it's not that it's impossible, but it's more challenging. It's more difficult to be able to find that same group of people.
Yeah. Now, so, I mean, I think, the team at SparkLabs here have done a tremendous amount of work at finding ambitious startups, and all our founders work really, really hard. And I think it's almost that taking that next step. And taking that next step requires strong investment. And I do find that you know, when we kicked off in Korea 6 years ago, you know, local investors were still very early stage. They were asking for stupid things like personal guarantees and all that crap. And most of those investors are gone, right? You know, and replaced by investors who actually knew what they were doing. But I feel that it's still quite early days here in Taiwan. And we do have good investors here, but there isn't enough yet support to help those companies go global. I mean, I think it is one of the key things here that I've found is probably one of the biggest stumbling blocks, which in Israel and Korea definitely overcome. Singapore absolutely overcome, but not here yet.
One of the things that when I first settled in here and I was asking, I mean, for the first few months, it was a pretty passive experience. It was just trying to meet everybody, either it's entrepreneurs, investors, on the government side of things, and it was trying to understand, you know, what were these stumbling blocks and how to be able to surpass these hurdles. And one of the, it always kind of came down to, well, there's not the amount of, you know, venture capital, the angel investors, there's not the excitement, enthusiasm, maybe the confidence to be able to want to invest. But at the same time, when talking with the investors, they're also saying that, well, there weren't that the sort of the opportunities out there that are available maybe in Silicon Valley and in Singapore and other places. And so if we have $100 to invest, we're going to be investing in startups and companies and co-founders with more experience. And then coming from these environments where there's already a sort of a history that demonstrates it's possible to be done here. So it's a circular loop, which is to say, you know, what is causing what?
It is a loop, isn't it? But do you think, therefore, for those investors, do they need to see more ambition from the startups to make them feel like, yes, I'm going to go for it?
Yeah, so I mean, put into a sentence, I would say things would be helped a lot more if someone can create a $1 billion company in the next couple of years in Taiwan. I mean, a startup that can do this. I think in some ways PayPal was the reason that so many of these entrepreneurs came out of PayPal and did all the things with David Sachs and Peter Thiel, Elon Musk. It was during this dot-com crash in 99, 2000 to be with this core group of people that had just gone through an amazing fundraising round, but all of a sudden you find yourselves locked in. You're not going to get funded for another 3-4 years. So what do you do with this with this sort of sizable checking account, but you know you have to make the most out of this. And there was success out of that, and I think that creates this, if anything, this sort of startup hard mentality that you can actually do this if you really want to try. And so I think it inspired all these folks that were part of PayPal early on to say, look, if you have a grand idea, why don't you give it a shot rather than giving up? Why don't you at least spend 6 months to a year? It doesn't take that long, to be honest. It doesn't take that long to know that your idea is not going to work. It doesn't take that long to know that there's something there. When it comes to hiring, for example, when I was hiring at YouTube, it was, you know, you have a sort of a 4-year vesting cycle, you have a 4-year stock grant, but the honest truth is, like, you don't need 4 years at any startup to know whether or not this startup is going to work. You're going to have a good idea by month 3, month 6, by year in, that this is going to work. It's not saying that you don't go in for the long haul, it's to say that, does this idea, do these founders, does this company, do these employees, this infrastructure, this company, is it going to work? And you can tell that pretty early on. And that was the case at YouTube, that was the case with PayPal. And I think that part of those good things that PayPal, those years at PayPal, what it taught us was, you know, you're trying to revolutionize how, you know, user-to-user payments, user-to-consumer payments, how it actually worked. And to be able to do that from a garage in Palo Alto is a major undertaking. But if you're successful in that, then, you know, whatever dreams you have, at least try it for a few months.
So when you meet founders here, what's your core advice for them when you see them? I mean, I know it's a very generalized sort of statement, but I mean, you know, how do you you've got incredible experience from PayPal, from YouTube, and everything in Silicon Valley, and they look to you and almost say, I want some of that, you know. how do you even start to get that across to them? But I mean, how do you, what are the things that you want to try and get in there as at a stage, especially as they're starting to scale?
I mean, I think ultimately it comes down to some very simple factors. And I think if you have to do, you know, a slide deck, and if you're supposed to be on stage for an hour, then you can get into all sorts of variables. But to be honest, it's just your idea and how well it's doing. You know, how many users are you getting? How many transactions are you getting? What's that sort of month over month growth? How many new users? What's the virality? This is how, you know, to be honest, it doesn't
basic
matter.
Growth.
Yeah, it doesn't matter if you're based in anywhere in the world. If you have a service, if you have a consumer service, if you have a business service, if it's growing fast, if it's doubling in usage every 6 weeks, it doesn't matter. But I think then it's, assuming that that's the factor that you're looking after, how do you do that? And that's when we get into, you have to know what your users want. You have to know, you know, where to apply your marketing dollars, if at all. You know, you have to know where to, who to hire. If you have $3 million in the bank, how long is this going to go for? How aggressively should you spend it, and how should you spend it? I think that all comes into it. But, you know, I think you have a few, two, three key metrics that you think your company requires to be able to gauge and judge at any given time what and how it's doing, and then just stay focused on that. It was something that we've always done, which is, you know, every time we would send every 24 hours we would send, and the key metrics at YouTube at the time was just the number of users created, although that was probably a lot less important than the two other factors, which was the number of videos that were uploaded every day on YouTube and the total number of views. And then there's a lot of other metrics as to, you know, what the virality, what the drop-off rate is, are people coming back to re-upload videos. But if you just keep it simple and just focus it on that, that's going to be, I mean, ultimately, that's going to be on the slide deck. You can have a five-page slide deck which shows these are the numbers. You know, I mean, I remember, yeah, the first deck we presented at Sequoia, I don't even think we had a slide about how we were going to monetize YouTube. It was just, this is growth, this is Series A round. All we're trying to do is get to 1 million views a day, and then we'll figure out the monetization later. And then we'll figure it out by selling to Google, you know.
which always works. so let's go to one other thing, which is, you know, obviously the reason why we have lots of masks in the audience today. So you and I went through the 2000 crash, and look, YouTube was born out of that, you know, and as you said, PayPal survived and thrived, and YouTube came out of that. Then 2008 came, and it was doom and gloom, $1 trillion out of the industry, but hey, you know, everything rebounded quite quickly. How do you think, we don't know what's going to happen, we don't know how it's going to happen, but we do know kind of what happens when, out of a world crisis, things rebound again. What do you think, what's your opinion about how things are going to go down this year? And how would you, if you're a founder out there, how do you think about what's going to happen to you?
I mean, in some ways, everything's happening so quickly. Everything's being compressed down. So, you know, you have the Dow Jones Industrial Average breaking all new records just a few weeks ago, and then falling by 8% in a day. So it's hard to know what's going to happen tomorrow, what's going to happen next week, much less, you know, what's going to happen in a few weeks to a few months. But I think in some ways, even through just personally, through private investments, I think in the private equity space, in the startup space, it's a little bit more insulated than what you have in the public market, right? And so I think, to be honest, with everything that was going on with YouTube back in 2008 and 2009, it was just at that time, it was looking at the acquisition by Google had already happened. So it was looking at things like the internationalization, how do you get out of just the US, and it's not just translation and localization, but it's also figuring out, you know, for every country in Thailand and in Korea, there's different protocols and legal codes that you have to abide by for user-to-user generated content. There was a lot of things about the iPhone at the time, and Apple's just difficult to work with, and so you spend a lot of time just trying to figure out how you actually work with all these other companies. So in a lot of ways, I think working in 2008, 2009. It wasn't until almost a few quarters later that you begin to kind of realize how big of a sort of a economic crash it was back then. The one in sort of 99, 2000, 2001, I thought that was actually very educational for me as well as a lot of the people that were, I'm going to say not just survived, but also didn't survive from Silicon Valley at the time. I think the lesson learned there was, you know, what had happened in the stock market for some of these services and ideas, it's unjustified because there still needs to be some consideration for the numbers and that potential monetization opportunity. So, you know, Google and Facebook, they can survive for however long they need to, as long as they have a viable service, as long as they can do it in a way that's, you know, economically efficient, and more importantly, as long as they can get investors to be able to invest money. But, you know, you still need to be able to, now after that dot-com crash, to be able to show that there is some finish line in sight in which you're going to be able to monetize this stuff. So I think that that first dot-com crash was helpful, and I think it corrected the mindset of the venture capitalists, the investors, to be able to kind of think long-term about, okay, these are the metrics, but you have to be able to deliver it in a way that's, again, economically feasible to continue to scale out. And I think that even in the short term, a lot of good ideas went away, but a lot of those ideas kind of revived over a period of time. I mean, I think some of the most successful startups that have gone public today, their ideas aren't fundamentally innovative at the time that they started the companies. Companies have tried to do that in the past.
That execution.
Right. And you know, just timing. It's not that YouTube, it was that innovative of an idea to share videos online. You know, you run the clock back to 2005, nobody thought that you could use, you know, at the time it was, you have to lay down cable, you have to lay down, you know, or satellite to be able to have enough data transport to be able to watch content. You're not going to be able to pay for streaming content every time you want to view this video. I mean, at the time that YouTube was sold, I remember that YouTube was using up 25% of the traffic on the internet. And to think that... I think a startup with 55 people can pay for 25% of the internet's traffic. It would have been, you know, when we were starting in our garage, and that would have been unfeasible. We said we give up now, but it is possible. But it was only possible in that 2005, 2006 era when there was so much of sort of that dark internet out there that you could actually start getting. You can start buying for a relatively cheap cost, and due to all of those variables, was it possible to have something like YouTube emerge?
So we're gonna finish up. So after every crisis, I always see that there are certain countries. There are countries that come out of it better than others. And funny enough, look, Taiwan. Everyone's sharing around the internet how well Taiwan's managed the crisis. Taiwan has gone onto the front page of everyone's news about how well it's done. And I think there's an opportunity for Taiwan in some ways to exploit that. It relatively so far doing okay. It's got a relatively strong position. And if you were advising people in Taiwan on how to manage your way and take advantage of this in 2020, what would you say? There's a question for you. I just came up with it, man. I should have told you about it beforehand, but yeah.
Well, I don't know. Yeah, just keep those face masks in Taiwan. Don't export them. I think it's hard to say. Being from San Francisco, being from the Bay Area, I am still sort of on a daily basis still connected with fathers there, with venture partners there. And this is in the last 72 hours, the fathers in the school that my kids used to go to, I'm still in the chat rooms, they were joking at how ridiculous that all these other countries, you know, Italy, how ridiculous it is to be able to start shutting things down. And then you get this email report that says we're shutting down the school for a month. I mean, that was 72 hours ago that the kids and their fathers were saying this is ridiculous to, we're going to have to start doing homeschooling because we're shutting down the school for four weeks. And in some ways, I think some of the schools in Taiwan, the school that my kids go to, they were actually a little bit more well-prepared for this than some of the other schools. I mean, I would be very curious to see how things are going to be played out in the next few weeks, even in the U.S. There's events like last year with South by Southwest. I saw that was just canceled. The entire football, soccer games are played without anybody. They're thinking about canceling some of the NBA games. I mean, the only thing that I know that has anything more than 500 people is this
in
event.
Today,
yeah.
Is this, which is crazy. Okay. Well, thanks, Dave. I'm, as I said, a passionate believer in Taiwan, I think, and its opportunities here. And particularly, you know, like I'm a big passionate believer in climate change and environment sustainability. I think that potentially is going to be one of the very big sectors going forward. I kind of feel the world's going to try and clean up its act after this in some ways.
No, I agree. So. And I think that's certainly an area where I think the Taiwan can play a role in, because it is an area where I think it is an area where you can create a model for a potentially innovative solution to a problem that's facing the globe. And if it works here, that's easily transportable. That's agnostic of language,
exactly.
of culture.
Yeah. Right. All right, well, thank you. So everyone, a big hand and warm welcome to Steve. He's back in Taiwan. I'm sure he's feeling very safe in Taiwan.
Thank you.
Very good. Thanks again. All right. And on with the show.
Great.
Yes.
Oh, do we have a QA? I don't think so. I think it's just a chat. Yeah. All right. I'm sure they'll come and find you afterwards. Yeah. All right. Thanks again, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you, Steve. Thank you, Frank.